we're navigating out there, if we're not testing and probing, we could all of a sudden work our way into a shallower area of ice and punch through. You can see how readily that can be brought up and chopped through, and then all of a sudden, we start hitting some thicker portions within about 2 feet of the bank. Evaluate ice. A couple probably legends or myths, urban legends or myths that I want to dispel. The most important one is cracks. Cracks are not always a bad thing. Cracks and lines in the ice form naturally as part of that ice development process. Now, cracks that can be problematic are cracks that have differentials in them. So if I've got a plane of ice that's kind of riding like this, and then a crack and the ice drops down and then another sheet of ice forms, that tells me that ice is settled at two different levels. There may be some separation between those two planes of ice. If I see a crack that has any kind of water percolating through it, then that's an unstable crack. Other than that, cracks should always be evaluated, but they're not always a point of weakness or something that indicates that that area of ice is unreliable. So cracks are formed through the compression of that water converting to things. You can have movement underneath that body of water, and just the pressure that's involved in water changing formation is gonna cause cracks and characteristics in the ice. As we talked about that radiant heat coming from the shallower areas, you're gonna have all kinds of progressions from no ice to thin ice to slush. Rivers are not always the only equation that's flowing water. Ponds can create a lot of disturbances and ice changes based on any water features that are in the pond, such as fountains or drain points, any passes through culverts, anywhere where that water is transitioning from point A to point B or recirculating is gonna cause water movement and gonna cause variables in the ice. That's why it's so important that you're constantly probing and analyzing. We already identified, so like out here at the edge, this is a good example of slush. I mean, that's really, really weak right there. Oh, it's kind of intermixing. You can see how readily that can be brought up and chopped through, and then all of a sudden, we start hitting some thicker portions within about 2 feet of the bank. And now we're right into immediately solid ice. As we progress across this, if we've got a water feature out here that's circulating or moving water, it may not be actively like spouting and visible from the edge. It may have been something that froze off or got shut off. And as we're navigating out there, if we're not testing and probing, we could all of a sudden work our way into a shallower area of ice and punch through. If you are ever out here and analyzing your path from point A to point B, and you do have to go get something or compelled to go do something, the most important thing I could probably encourage you to do is follow a path that's already been developed. Even if I have a victim on the ice, if I can see how they traversed across the ice to get to where they ended up at, and I can get a basic idea of how big they are, whether it's a kid or an adult, a dog, that gives me at least a load coefficient that I know the ice held from that point to that point. Everything else I'm doing on virgin ice for the first time is untested. So I gotta move a lot slower and a lot more cautiously to make sure that I'm evaluating every path that I take. I take that known path, I can move with a lot more confidence knowing that that ice supported them to at least get from here to there. Other things you wanna be conscientious about, anything that's protruding from the ice. So like over here, we basically got a piece of angled steel coming up out of the water body. Anytime you have natural formations, organics coming up out of the water body, where those things tie into the ice surface, those may be some of your later areas forming with ice. So as you get closer to those contact points, see back here, these may be much weaker or they may be much stronger, but you gotta think of these as inconsistencies. So as things form around those areas and those objects, always be conscientious about them. You can see I'm almost chipping through right there next to that angle. Those will interact differently with the sun and with the heat. They'll transfer that heat down through the ice surface and they'll impact that ice that's immediately around them and immediately contacting them. Okay, so if you live in a community or an area where maybe you don't have access to that web-based application where you can get online, find out whether it's safe to get on the ice or not, there is a basic formula. In a 24-hour period of time, what you can take is the lowest temperature for that 24-hour period of time and the highest temperature for that period of time and find the average. So let's say that our high in a 24-hour period was 10 degrees Fahrenheit and our low was zero. Then our average for that 24-hour period of time is gonna be 5. There's two coefficients that you're gonna use once you figure out that number. The first one is 32 degrees, that's when water freezes. So we're going to take 32 degrees and we're going to subtract 5 from it. We're going to take that number then and we're going to look at it in relationship to this magic coefficient. And this magic coefficient is roughly or approximately ice will be generated at 1 inch per 15 days, per 15 freezing days. And this number we're coming up with is called a freezing day number, all right? So if we know ice is going to form 1 inch in these 15 freezing days, I subtract that 5 from that 32, I'm going to look at that number. If that number is in excess of 15, then I know in that 24-hour period of time, I'm going to form more than an inch of ice. If I'm less than that 15, I'm not going to form as much. So that's kind of your basic benchmark to work through that calculation, especially if you got a private pond on a farm or something on those lines. You want to let your kids go out and ice skate and play things like that. Try to use that basic template. And remember, we're looking for at least 5 inches of ice to really safely operate out on the ice and be active with a group of people.